Okay, so welcome to this confinement talk. So I'm going to talk about this work that I've done in collaboration with people from Harvard and from the Ministry of Health and Sanitation in the Republic of Sierra Leone and the World Health Organization. It's called the Incubation Periods Impact the Spatial Predictability of Cholera and Ebola Outbreaks in Sierra Leone. So first I wanted to see, so now that we are in the middle of this pandemic, and to see what pandemics have been in history or are documented out there. So I found this, the oldest one that I could find is something that it is not sure that it was because of an epidemic, but probably it was something like that. It's a prehistoric site, archaeological site in China, where they dated like 5,000 years ago, where they found around 100 skeletons packed in a tent or a place to live. They hypothesized that probably there was an epidemic outbreak in that region, and they didn't have time to bury the corpses, so they just put it into that house, and there is evidence that the house was burnt. We don't know if they burnt it altogether or what. But the thing is, they didn't come back to live there anymore. So epidemics have been with us for a long, long, long time. So I guess probably since the beginning. If you look in the Wikipedia, you can find a list of 234 documented epidemics. And you see the first ones that you have there in the Wikipedia start in the fourth century before Christ in Greece, with the plague of Athens, and then you have lots of them. So what else? Yeah, I wanted to see also to put here a timeline of epidemics or pandemics, and I found this infographics that is really amazing, where you can see the timing and death toll of several of the most of the worst pandemics that we have had in history. No, there you can see the bubonic plague with 200 million deaths. You can see the smallpox in the 16th century with 56 million deaths. You can see more near to now things like HIV, AIDS, which is an ongoing pandemic, which has already 25 to 35 million deaths, or the Spanish flu in 1920. And so it's great. I can give you the link if you want, and you can see this visually. You can see some of the numbers for that. So we have had many, it is not specific for humans, but animals in wild animals, it is common to have epidemics. So right now there are fungi epidemics in amphibians, which are doing a lot of damage to protected species of amphibians. In Mexico, the US, there is West Nile encephalitis epidemics going on, mostly in birds. So it is vector-borne through mosquitoes, and many birds, many crows have died already there. So the Tasmanian devil has a type of infectious tumor that they pass to each other, mostly by biting, and they bite a lot between them when they mate. And this little animal, the koala, which may look cute, but it may have chlamydia. So they have this sexual transmitted disease, the same as humans can have. So we have had many, and this is not particular for us. We are having also, so that was kind of the past, the present is that we have, so this is from the Eastern Mediterranean Regional Office of the World Health Organization. This, I took this yesterday from their webpage, where they record what are the outbreaks in the Eastern Mediterranean countries of different diseases. And this is current ones. So you see that the yellow wedge is coronavirus. But in places like in Lebanon, you have outbreaks of hepatitis A or measles. In Saudi Arabia, United Arab Emirates, and so on, you have MERS. And this is very, very near to us. In fact, this Eastern Mediterranean Regional Office of World Health Organization, of WHO, lists 23 diseases that are already doing their job, so to say, in humans, that are pandemic prone or epidemic or pandemic prone. And you can see many of them. So it's a threat that is currently happening. More than that, we have epidemics or pandemics to come, mostly due to global change or climate change. So it is so the most direct relation is that it is expected to alter the geographic and seasonal distributions of existing vectors and vector-borne diseases. So, you cannot see the map. So here we should have a map. Wait. Okay, let me show it to you like this. So this is the map of predicted risk of dengue in the world, and under some assumptions of global change, you see basically this is the number of months that you're in risk of getting dengue. And it is vector-borne through a mosquito, the Aedes aegypti, actually another one too, but I just show this one. And what you see, I wanted you to note, is that if you look at Europe or Asia, as time goes, this is invading north latitudes. Okay, so another climate connection with disease is, for example, this one is interesting, which is the connection of El Niño with malaria cases in Venezuela. And you see that basically 1 year after an El Niño event, you have many more cases. And as with climate change, we expect these events to be more frequent, and we expect also these outbreaks to be more frequent. Okay, so we have seen what has been, what is there, and what will come a little bit, more or less. So let's see what's the work we've done about epidemics. So first I will do an introduction of why we use cholera and Ebola, and what are their epidemiological characteristics, and why in Sierra Leone. Then I will show you how it spread in Sierra Leone and what do we learn from it. So basically an analysis of the epidemic data. Then we'll have a modeling part where we will try to relate the spreading characteristics of these diseases to the epidemiological parameters. And last, we'll have some conclusions. So why cholera and Ebola in Sierra Leone? So what we want to do is to study the effect on spreading patterns of different incubation periods, while the rest of relevant parameters remain unchanged. So you need several things to do that. So first you need two diseases that are not the same, but are similar enough. So we take Ebola and cholera. Why do we say that they are similar enough? Okay, the transmission of both is through contact with contaminated diarrhea or vomitus, plus other bodily fluids for Ebola. They have an R0 or R0 between 1 and 3. I'll come back in the next slide to this number. So if you don't know what is R0, I will explain in a while. They both cause immobilizing gastrointestinal symptoms of diarrhea and vomiting. So basically, once you have the symptoms, once you develop the disease, you cannot move and yeah. If it is left untreated, the case fatality rates exceed 50%. Although for cholera, when treated, you can go as far down as 1% for fatality rates. I also have to say that for cholera, we have oral vaccines since a long time ago. I think it's in the 60s, probably. There are injectable vaccines also and so on. But for Ebola, the first vaccine approved by the FDA in the US was in December last year. cultural factors and rituals, such as traditional funeral practices, are known to influence this spread because they touch the corpses. And typical programs, which have been for reducing the spread of each, are what are called WASH programs, water, sanitation, and hygiene. Okay, this makes them very similar. But the incubation period for one and the other is pretty different. So for Ebola, you have 8 to 12 days of incubation period, while for cholera, you have 1 to 2 days. Okay? Okay, so we have the diseases. Now, if we want to see them in a real setting, we need something else to happen. And this is, of course, opportunistic. And the thing is that two epidemics of cholera and Ebola happened pretty much close in time in Sierra Leone, one for cholera in 2012 to 2013, and Ebola 2014 to 2015. For Ebola, you had this almost 12,000 cases and almost 4,000 deaths, while for cholera, you had 22,000 cases and 324 deaths. This number is the number of deaths is much slow and much lower for cholera because of what I said before. Just with treatment, pretty basic treatment, you can lower the death rate a lot. But both epidemics occurred against an immunologically naive population. Travel patterns and density of the distribution of people were broadly similar. Although for Ebola there were some lockdowns, some city lockdowns, so this could have impacted the movements, the regular movements, more for Ebola than for cholera. So this is a perfect opportunity to compare two very similar diseases in two very similar substrates with the difference that you have the incubation period different. So our hypothesis is that if we observe differences in the spreading, incubation period should be one of the drivers or one very influential driver of these differences in patterns of disease spread. Okay, so I talked about a couple of concepts that not everybody has to be familiar with. The first one is R0. R0 is the basic reproductive number. So it is defined as the number of cases that are directly generated by one case in a population where all individuals are susceptible to infection. So basically, when it is bigger than one, every infected individual along his disease or his infectious period creates more than one secondary infection, and there is an outbreak. If it's less than one, there is no outbreak. It's like in percolation. DSR0 is affected by several factors, including the duration of the infectivity of affected patients, infectiousness of the organism, number of susceptible people in the population that the infected patients are in contact with. So it's agglomerating a lot of things. So it is not a natural constant, so to say, for a pathogen. So you need to take into account what are the interactions in order to get your R0. It itself doesn't give an estimate of how fast an infection spreads in a population. So imagine if this is the number of secondary cases. So if you have a very long disease, if I have a disease that is 10 years long in my body, but R0 is just 2, every 5 years I infect one, so it's very slow, but in principle there is an epidemic going on. This basic reproduction number is not to be confused with the effective reproduction number, which is the number of cases that are generated when with the current state of the population. So you don't need to have everybody susceptible. So by definition, R0 is on a fully susceptible population. So you cannot, given the population, the mobilities, the interactions, and the disease, this R0 is fixed. So you don't put into R0 your campaigns. You put it into the effective reproductive number, and you can see some numbers of this R0. No? Sarampion, measles has a great R0, and you can see here COVID-19 is also cited. It's between 1.4 and 3.9. So basically, if you are all of these that are over one are very very, very pandemic prone or epidemic prone. Okay, so we are lucky MERS is under that. Another characteristic I've talked about is sometimes the incubation period. So there are two periods to have into account. So one is the latent period. The latent period is the time from when individuals are infected to when they become infectious. So if you see this figure, can you see my cursor?
Yes, okay. We can see it.
Ah, you can see? Okay. Yes. So
yes.
The latent period is so if infection starts at time zero, you have a latent period where you're not infectious but you have been infected, and then you have a period of communicability. The incubation period is the time since you get infected to when you develop the disease, or developing the disease is developing symptoms. So these two periods may not overlap completely. And when the latent period is shorter than the incubation period, you have presymptomatic transmission, which can be a strong driver of this R0. So because basically you don't know that you are already infected and you are already infectious. For the diseases that we are taking here into account, there is a strong relation between pathogen charge in your body and symptoms, so that the latent period and incubation period are practically the same. But this could be, this is discussed that for coronavirus right now, this do not align perfectly. And you have one day probably here between the incubation period, the latent period and the incubation period. So you have presymptomatic transmission. So the incubation period is also by itself likely to play a particularly important role in determining the spatial spread of an epidemic, because once typical travel may continue prior disease, But then you could stop your disease either because you have symptoms that are immobilizing, or because you know you're sick, so you try to do some kind of quarantine, or you just don't travel. Okay. So, okay. What is Ebola? Just a small... Wait a second, I'm going to close the door so we don't get noise. So I've told you these diseases are very, very similar in many aspects, but they are also very different. So Ebola is a virus which does these gastrointestinal things. It lives in a reservoir of bats, typically. And can infect through bat bites to other animals. And if people hunt them, then they can get infected, and that's the cycle of it. So the reservoir is in bats, and it's a virus. What about cholera? Cholera is produced by a bacteria, Vibrio cholerae, and its reservoir is water. So it lives in water and in contact with that water. Water, typically, if people have this diarrhea, water is then contaminated, and from the water it gets through food or drinking into the body. So actually, they are different. Epidemiologically, we will not take this into account, but they are pretty different. One is a virus, the other is a bacteria. One has a reservoir in bats, the other one has it in water. But for the sake of this work, this isn't important, actually, because transmission is with contact with this vomitus and diarrhea. So basically, human contact in the end. Although there could be Ebola, cholera, Sierra Leone. What is Sierra Leone? Sierra Leone is an African country with 7 million population. It's between Guinea and Liberia. It has four regions. It's divided in four regions. The one that is so small is where Freetown is, which is the capital, with 1 million inhabitants, a little bit less. Then it's further divided into districts, 12 districts, and into chiefdoms, and they have 149 chiefdoms. It's pretty rural, and transport is pretty. So many people go by foot from place to place, and the routes are not so good. So 80% of people is employed in agriculture. I guess you know they had a civil war, they have diamond mines. Okay. So what happened there with Ebola and cholera? Here you can see in the left column, cholera, in the right, Ebola. And if you look at the top panels, A and B, you see the contour lines of disease spread. So what you see, they both spread through more than 75% of the chiefdoms in the country. And the spread of cholera, you can see in the bottom, top left, that went from northwest following a radial spatial dispersion gradually in all directions. While Ebola started Ebola is top right, started in the south southeast for 2 months, and then rapidly sparked, rapidly expanded or jumped to the northwest, and went to all of Sierra Leone. You can see that the timings are very fast at some point with Ebola, because the thick lines are pretty separated among each other, while for cholera it was slower. So despite these differences in the spatiotemporal spread, when you look at the cumulative attack rate, so that is the proportion of people that of each chiefdom that were infected after the that have been infected after the outbreak went. This is the bottom panels. So the attack, this attack rate is pretty similar for both, although the trajectories were different. So let's see it on a video. I put on the top this contour line so you can follow a little bit. So you see cholera, there's in the beginning something, and now cholera will start. So maybe we have to do it twice. Now cholera will start doing this kind of radial expansion. While if you have been looking at Ebola, because Ebola now is almost over, let me start it again. So if you look at Ebola, it starts in the south southeast. It has some cases far away, and at a certain moment now everything starts having activity, a more synchronized activity, so to say. So absence of this kind of front. Okay, so I hope I've convinced you already that the trajectories are different, but let's dig a little bit deeper in the data. So let's take a look at the effective reproduction number in time and in space. In the top, you can see the for each chiefdom, the number of days. So this is divided into quartiles. And so the number of days that a chiefdom stayed with an effective reproductive number that was over one. Over one means that you will sustain the epidemic. In the middle, you can see in the black line is the effective reproductive number for the whole country, while the bars are the weekly counts of infected per region. And the regions are depicted here. If you see my cursor here, it are the four regions in Sierra Leone. And in the bottom, you see the effective reproduction number per region. So, while some areas sustain transmission with RT bigger than one for several days, like in Freetown for both, and the yellow and white is that they had 0 days of RT over one or no cases. And actually, 75 of chiefdoms during the cholera outbreak and 44% of chiefdoms during the Ebola outbreak had either 0 cases or 0 days with effective reproductive number over one. So that means that it is heterogeneously distributed who is sustaining the epidemics. And you see the pattern, like a signature of these different ways of spreading, in what are the foci of this sustained spreading, which is for cholera around Freetown, and for Ebola more dispersed with a multifocal pattern. Okay, so the effective what you can see with the effective in the middle panel is that cholera shows a peaked incidence curve that rises fast soon after a maintained global effective reproductive number over one. While for Ebola, you need a little bit more time of sustained RT to get this incidence curve rising, and the peak of them is much broader. Okay.
Sorry, Juan, just may I ask a question?
Yes.
Just the definition of the effective reproductive number. Is just the ratio between cases and new cases? Or there is some subtlety on
there is a pretty, pretty, it's A little bit complicated. So this is a maximum likelihood estimate of, given the infections that you have now, how many of the ones that you're gonna see are attributable to those infections. Mm-hmm. But this is, so there is a whole paper describing this okay. kind of methodology. Okay. So I can give you the reference, but this is a maximum likelihood estimate of that thing. No, now I know I have these infected people, and now I know later the people that will be there, and you need to do some assumptions on what is the serial interval, which is the time, basically the duration of the illness. So you need several assumptions for that.
Okay.
Okay, spatial correlations. So now you will see cholera is the red line, Ebola is the blue line, and this panel show spatial correlations among chiefdoms for disease presence, which is just yes, no. Outbreak onset, which is defined as the week of the first reported case on that chiefdom. Cumulative cases, which is the total number of cases after the epidemic, and cumulative attack rate, which is the proportion of individuals infected during the outbreak. So transmission intensity of both diseases was positively correlated in chiefdoms near each other. Correlation decayed with distance, and so up to 100 kilometers you can find some correlation, then it basically disappears. Case count, which is cumulative cases, the C, that is very similar for both. My take is that this is more related to the populations, because this is just counting, this is an absolute number. So the correlations of that is the correlations that you have in populations. So if you want to see differences, you have to look at the cumulative attack rate. So, and one thing that is, although confidence intervals overlap, it seems that cholera, which has a shorter incubation period, has more correlations, more spatial correlations. So what do we learn from this spatial temporal spread of cholera and Ebola in Sierra Leone, and what would we want to capture in a simple model? Very, 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 very simplistic, I have to emphasize that. So first, we have observed that shorter incubation periods show some kind of wave-like spreading patterns, while longer ones display jumps in the spatial spreading. Shorter incubation periods have more peaked incidence curves, while the other ones are, just the opposite. And shorter incubation periods seem to produce higher correlations, higher spatial correlations. So all of these things, as I was saying before in the preamble, in the introduction, we would like to capture these things, but only with having one free parameter, which is the incubation period. So that is the challenge, I think. So what is the model? It's a very, 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 very basic model. So you have susceptible individuals, which when they are exposed to an infected individual, when they meet an infected individual at rate lambda, they transit to the exposed compartment. Once they are there, after after the incubation period of tau I, they go to be infectious, infected and infectious. So the E is not infectious. and infectious agents after D days go to the recovered state. We are not doing any difference between recovered and deaths, because we are not taking that into account here. we didn't even analyze that. So, okay, you have this basic SEIR model, but not with rates. This is the difference with some other works that we are used to, where people put rates to go from E to I and from I to R. This gives you an exponential distribution of times of transit, but here we have a fixed time of transit. So further expansions of this would be to give some width to this distribution. So, but once you have this, you don't have everything to simulate the model. You need a substrate, a population and spatial substrate. So this substrate will be a metapopulation approach. We will simulate this with in an agent-based approach. 45,000 agents distributed equally in 150 locations, evenly spaced in a 15 by 10 lattice. We tried heterogeneous populations that were in line with the heterogeneity in Sierra Leone, but it yielded similar results. So we stick to the simplest case that can give us some insight. For the mobility, S, E, and R individuals, so susceptible, exposed, and recovered, can travel normally, which means that they have a probability P of moving per day, while infectious individuals do not move. Results are similar if you do a drastic reduction of infectious individuals. So we stick again to this more simple case where infected individuals do not move, infected and infectious. That means that they have developed the disease and they are vomiting and having diarrhea, so they cannot move. Movement is following a simple gravity model, so we wanted to do some mobility that was kind of inspired in reality. In the end, as we were doing these simplifications with the population structure and so on, this means that you can travel to cells with a probability that decays with the inverse square of the distance between cells. We tried different parametrizations also of the gravity model and it yields similar results. So we performed 700 simulations of the epidemics for incubation periods ranging from 1 day to 14 days. And we see the epidemic always at the same location near the center of the lattice. Okay, so let's see some results. So here you can see in A, the incidence curve for different incubation periods from 1 to 14. So 1 is the more peaked one, 14 the most spread. So we are capturing already this kind of phenomenology that we saw in the comparison between Ebola and cholera, no? that longer incubation periods produce a not so peaked incidence curve that is also more spread in time. Okay, if you see below C and D, you can see the contour lines as we were seeing before. For a disease with an
incubation track.
Yes? Hello? Okay. So below you can see the contour lines of two realizations of one with a period of, this is two realizations? I'm not sure if this is two one realization each. No, I don't think so. No, this is one realization. No, this is one realization each. And so, yeah, sorry, I got distracted. C is for an incubation period of 2 days, D for an incubation period of 10 days. And we see kind of that the fronts are distorted for the for longer incubation periods, and this is related in principle to this sparking events, to these events where you have suddenly someone some outbreak going on pretty far from the initial seat of the outbreak. So what happens also when you do the okay, longer incubation periods peak later, and although the epidemics tend to last longer for diseases with longer incubation periods, the spread of the disease to more distant locations can progress more quickly, causing a discontinuous and more rapidly spreading wave front. What do we mean by that? So if now you look at B, so B tells me on all the lattice, on all of the lattice, given the incubation period in the x-axis, what is the average starting time of the outbreak in each side of the lattice? So, and what we see is that the average starting time is actually slower for longer incubation periods. What does that mean? That means that once you start in one place, but you get once the outbreak comes to other places, it comes to many other places. So it is actually spreading faster. Although the pace of the epidemics is slower and will take more time. So one way of that was what. The first 50 days of a location. Yeah. So one way of explaining this is imagine a dispersion kernel that we define as the probability that one agent will end up at a position separated a distance d from the initial position after x days. Okay. So imagine I get infected at day zero, and then at day x, this kernel tells me what is the probability that I am at distance d from that place. So we should use different kernels for different incubation periods. So I've plotted the kernel for a very basic mobility where you can just go up, down, left or right with equal probability and one for half probability of not moving on a 50 by 50 lattice. And what you see is that this kernel, the longer the incubation period, the flatter it gets. So basically, what I'm saying is that you are diffusing all of the time that you have this, that you are on the latent state, and then you stop because of the illness. So this kernel is responsible for the spreading. So if you have a more flat kernel, that means that basically you could be everywhere, anywhere. You could have diffused anywhere from when you got infected to when you show symptoms of infections and are infectious. And this is the driver for these different characteristics of spreading. What else? We also saw that spatial correlations were higher for shorter incubation periods. And this is something that we also see for our model. So you can see as a function of the incubation period, the average spatial correlation decays with the incubation period. It is also seen in C. This is by distance from the origin of the epidemics. You see that there is some decay in correlations, and that the correlations globally are smaller if the incubation period is longer. Another interesting fact about this is the predictability of outbreaks. So we already have a feeling from what I've told you, if you believe me, you know, that if you have this kind of wave-like patterns, you will predict it much easier than with this multifocal spreading that can have these sparking events of outbreaks going on very far away. So we try to formalize this with a measure. So imagine you have this pi j is a vector, and j, the pi is a vector, and pi j is the proportion of infected individuals in location j at time t for one simulation. Now I can have pi j 1 for one simulation, pi j 2 for another simulation, and this is just a measure of how similar both are. It's a kind of overlap. So if you then do many simulations and you compute the average of by pairs of these overlaps, if you have a very high overlap, that means that both trajectories of the epidemics were very similar. If it is close to zero, it means that they were completely different. So when you do that for different incubation periods, what you see is that for lower incubation period, you have a higher predictability, while for a bigger incubation period, so this decays, you have less predictability. So it is less predictable the longer the incubation period, which is, so I think now it's kind of common sense that if you have a long incubation period, you have many problems because also when you are reporting the number of infected individuals, you are not seeing the real thing that is gonna happen in a couple of weeks. You have something with delay, it's very difficult to control. But there is so common knowledge was supposed to be that longer incubation periods would give more time for reactive interventions. Well, it is not like that, because you cannot predict with these longer incubation periods. It's kind of anti-intuitive. So I think I went way too fast, because I should have had for an hour with this. But let's go to summary and discussions. We'll have more time for questions. This is very brief, but four main points that I wanted to highlight. That the analysis of cholera and Ebola epidemics have revealed commonalities and differences in the way these pathogens spread. And our simulation suggests that the differences in the incubation period reproduce these differences. We find that outbreaks with pathogens with longer incubation periods, such as Ebola, tend to have less predictable spread, whereas pathogens with shorter incubation periods, such as cholera, spread in a more predictable wave-like pattern. These findings have actually implications for the scale and timing of reactive interventions, such as vaccination. Regional ring vaccination, that is taking a focus of an outbreak and then saying, okay, 50 kilometers around, I will vaccinate everybody so that we contain this there. So that may be better suited to diseases with short incubation periods. While for longer incubation periods, what you would need is something like contact tracing and do this kind of ring vaccination, but kind of network ring vaccination. This is actually what is happening now, no? What they did very, very aggressively in Korea, no? The contact tracing in South Korea for which cases might be there in the population. So finally, our simulation model provides a proof of concept. So it's by far not realistic, but it's a proof of concept test of the hypothesis that of the impact of the incubation period on disease spread, and makes a lot of simplifying assumptions. So here I wanted to add this, so an open question is so something I at some point would like to work on is if we can kind of do a rescaling of one model to another, because basically all of the plots I have shown that of how it how the characteristics of the spreading vary with the incubation periods. All the plots are smooth, so there is no actual, there doesn't seem to be an actual transition from wave-like to something with these long-range sparking events. So probably this separation can be thought or can be framed into what are the timescales involved in the disease, in the population, and probably everything can come together to a more compact form. So I just want to thank you for being there at home listening to me. And yeah, time for questions. Thank you, Maxi. Nobody raises the hand, no. Emilio, yeah.
I raise my hand.
Okay.
In your mobility model, you are assuming a simple random walk. Well, not simple, it's a gravity model, but it's random walk. So any individual can go to a place and then can go arbitrarily to another place, another place. Will things be different if you have some probability of returning home, so that people go away and then return home? Do you think this will change some of the
conditions? Yes, I don't think that qualitatively will change that, but this is so related to well, for the people who were there on Monday with Sandro talking. I think that we are overestimating both travel and transmission with this assumption. So I think that what we will see is a reduction on the infected patients, infected individuals. If we take into account this, maybe I'm wrong, and there are other side effects of this, but. So if you are returning home, but depending on what you do, if you do there are random walk models where you have a probability of returning home, there are I think that will do basically the same with maybe you have to wait more time or no, you will have less infected. There are others where you could take into account just recurrent mobility, and this might have a bigger impact, because there you have to, so you need to have some kind of long distance connection in order to have the sparking events. And the long distance connection here comes from the fact that if you are traveling more time, you can end up farther away. So it doesn't matter how you put the long distance connection, but once you have the long distance connections, you have this Ebola-like pattern. That is my take. Did that respond somehow to your question?
Yes. Thank you.
Someone else?
Juan, yeah. Juan, if you said at the beginning that most of the people walk there. So if they walk, they cannot walk that much. How can you justify this long distance connection only by assuming that the people walk from one side to the other?
They do not only walk. So I mostly is I so from what I but I don't have any official data. But there are also buses, but not so many. So the thing is, if you go from one side of the country to other side of the country, you will take a bus, but locally and much more than here. So maybe you have to go somewhere like the university, you just walk. Mm-hmm. And you don't take a, the thing is they don't have cars. So they don't have at times the time scale of the typical time scale of traveling is much more there than in our country. That is what I wanted to highlight.
Okay.
Because probably if you had very very nice transport infrastructure in there, my guess is that then Ebola and cholera would look much much closer in their trajectories.
Well, it would be a disaster, probably.
Yeah?
Would be a disaster, probably, no? Because yes, the contact would be immense compared to this one.
Yes. So the disaster comes from this fact, actually. So mm-hmm. Ebola was much more synchronized all over the country. Suddenly everybody is infected. It's like now with coronavirus, no? Ah, it's not happening, not happening, and suddenly everybody has it, no? Mm-hmm. So it's this kind of thing. And now if you would make the travel patterns much more fast, even with a smaller incubation period, you would have this locally, this very, very high, very fast spreading. At least that is my take from this work.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Juan?
Yes?
I have a question. Sorry, I didn't understand very well the individual-based model. So you need some kind of social distance between individuals to get infected?
So inside the cells of the grid, they are all to all. So you have 45,000 agents, but only 150 locations. Okay. So that means in each location you have several. So it's like a box where they are well mixed. And actually what we did is to fix the rate lambda so that during the life of an infected individual, it would create 1.5 secondary cases.
Okay.
So this kind of so this is related to the question by Claudio. This kind of substrate is also trying to capture the mobility, a very very simplified mobility of that type of country with that type of transport.
Juan, may I ask another question?
Yes.
It's related to the discussion we had the other day with Raul. You are in this model, you are assuming that for changing from exposed to infected and then to recover, there are fixed times.
Yes.
Another, as you mentioned, and the a more common modeling approach is to assume that there is some from exposed to infected and then to recovery, there is an exponential distribution of times, which is, and then you can write differential equations. Have you checked, or has anyone checked, if the using differential equations for the rate approach for every transition makes a big difference with respect to this fixed time waiting time?
I don't have the simulations here, but we started by doing that, and you get more wave-like pattern for this substrate that we have put, as you can transit to the eye very rapidly. You get the wave-like pattern even for longer typical times of incubation. That is what I can remember from what we tried at the beginning. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
So I think it is for making this different patterns, it is crucial that you are not using a rate. But I might be wrong, because I'm not sure. So it's I think 3 years ago that I started that I did those simulations. So I wouldn't put my hand on the fire, but I think for this it is crucial. And anybody else? If not, then...
No more questions?
No more questions.
Then stay safe. Stay.
Gracias, Juan.
Gracias, Juan.
Yes. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thanks to all.
Bye.
Gracias. Bye.